Previously on Cinema Therapy.
The narrator, Ed Norton, and Brad Pitt's character, Tyler Durden, are two personalities inhabiting the same body via dissociative identity disorder. And Brad Pitt's character represents the it. He represents all these powerful impulses and desires. And Ed Norton, he is the superego. It's all law, it's all order, it's all structure.
So this movie came out when I was 18 years old, and we started a fight club.
And up until this channel, that was Alan's legacy if he left the world.
Like, that was it.
That was all he...
Tyler Durden's wardrobe might be the greatest wardrobe for any character ever in a movie. And because it tells you so much about him.
So lead off, what does it tell us about him?
Today's episode is sponsored by BetterHelp. Visit betterhelp.com/cinematherapy and get 10% off your first month of therapy.
It tells us that he doesn't give a f***. He has zero f*** to give. You know, it's Brad Pitt wearing it, so, you know, obviously he can wear a mesh shirt that says hustling and he still looks great because he's Brad Pitt. But, like, he doesn't care. It's obviously just thrift store garbage. These are not things that own him. This is stuff he picked up off the street and he just threw it on because who cares?
You know, I had a different read on it, but it is thrift store garbage, but it's also, like, stylish.
Oh, totally.
Because he's narrator's projection of the ideal male.
Sure.
Right? So even though he lives in this grungy place and he's free from material possessions, he also looks like $1 million or a really well spent 10 bucks, right? As it were. The shirt that he's wearing in that scene about the rules, he looks like a guy who takes care of himself. You know, like his hair's always done nice. He's always. So Tyler Durden starts sleeping with Marla, and it's no surprise he doesn't call it making love. He calls it sport. And that's because that's all id. And narrator's jealous as hell about it. But Tyler Durden also gives voice to narrator's discontent with the modern world and with what he's been living with. When you talked about early on, Gabe, about how narrator hates his job, Alan, you talked about giving his balls to corporate America. Tyler's gonna give voice here to what the discontent actually is.
Man, I see in Fight Club the strongest and smartest men who've ever lived. I see all this potential, and I see it squandered. God an entire generation pumping gas, waiting tables, slaves with white collars. Advertising has us chasing cars and clothes, working jobs we hate so we can buy shit we don't need. We're the middle children of history, man. No purpose or place. We have no great war, no great depression. Our great war is a spiritual war. Our great depression is our lives. We've all been raised on television to believe that one day we'd all be millionaires and movie gods and rock stars, but we won't. We're slowly learning that fact. And we're very, very pissed off.
I do recognize the irony that Brad Pitt says we're not all going to be movie stars and movie gods and rock stars, and we're saying this talking to an actual hero professional athlete.
I think we all have a piece of us that's pissed off that we weren't dealt the cards, and I was dealt very favorable cards and recognize that, but many people were not dealt cards that they're pleased with, and they're pissed off and looking for outlets and ways to sort of get some of that aggression out. So yeah, I mean, it landed with me in a great number of ways. And as we go through the scenes, it continues to.
We know our show is pretty awesome.
So awesome.
And we talk about therapeutic principles, but
it's not actually therapy.
No, it isn't.
Which is why we want to give you an option for therapy if you need therapy.
BetterHelp! Thank you for sponsoring this video. BetterHelp.
BetterHelp will assess your needs and match you with a licensed professional therapist, and you can start communicating within 48 hours, yo!
Yo, it is not self-help. It is not a crisis line. What it is actual professional therapy done securely on the interwebs.
BetterHelp has a network of over 20,000 therapists with a broad range of expertise.
That's a lot.
It's available for clients worldwide. So here's what you're gonna do. So you log in, you tell them what type of therapy you're looking for, what your gender is, what your age. These are the demographic questions all therapists ask. I ask all my clients this. What you're here for, what type of things you're working on, what country you live in, and now they're gonna start matching you with who you need. It's so much easier to meet with someone on BetterHelp instead of in office. So many perks and benefits. Over 20,000 licensed counselors, and you can message them anytime, anywhere.
You can send messages to your therapist right through the app, and you can also schedule a weekly video or phone session.
BetterHelp is committed to making sure you have a good therapeutic match, so changing therapists is easy and free.
It is more affordable than traditional offline therapy, and if that's not enough, there's financial aid available.
What?
Say what?
Visit betterhelp.com/cinematherapy, that's better H-E-L-P, and join over 2 million people taking charge of their mental health with an experienced professional today.
Click the link below and get 10% off your first month at betterhelp.com/cinematherapy, not bettercinema.help.com/therapy. Why am I talking still?
You know, I see this as a warning, and thank you for that, Gabe, because I think you're absolutely right. I see this as a warning, how our discontent can be weaponized. And we've seen this in politics, and we've seen this in many different ways. Alan's going to hate me for this, but of the Star Wars prequels, but Palpatine says to Anakin,
"Ever since I've known you, you've been searching for a life greater than that of an ordinary Jedi, a life of significance, of conscience."
And Anakin doesn't feel like he has it, and that's Palpatine's in. And I think whether it's from a cult leader like Tyler Durden turns out to be, or you know, people in politics who turn the screws or who use us for their own ends, religious leaders or family members or boyfriends or girlfriends or wives or husbands, or there are people who can weaponize our unhappiness and we against us or against others.
Yeah.
Right. And so for most of the film, we're thinking Tyler Durden is super cool and we all want to be like him. And then it slowly starts to turn into, oh no, this is going to a very dark, very ugly, very bad place.
Stop, what are you doing? Come on.
Hands behind your back.
God.
Give me your wallet. Raymond K. Hessel, 1320 Southeast Banning, apartment A. Small cramped basement apartment, Raymond.
How did you know?
Because they give basement apartments letters instead of numbers. Raymond, you're going to die. Is that your mom and dad? Mom and dad are going to have to call up kindly Dr. So-and-so. Pick up your dental records. Want to know why? Because there's going to be nothing left to face.
Oh, come on. Come
An expired on. Community college student ID. What'd you study, Raymond?
Stuff.
Stuff? Where the midterms are? I asked you what you studied.
Biology, mostly.
Why?
I don't know.
What did you want to be, Raymond K. Hessel? The question, Raymond, was what did you want to be?
Answer him, Raymond. Jesus.
Veterinarian.
Animals.
Yeah, animals. So.
Stuff, yeah, I got that. That means you have to get more schooling.
Too much school.
Would you rather be dead?
No.
You'd rather die here on your knees in the back of a convenience store?
No, please, no.
This scene's so compelling. Like, I feel like we should have commentary about this, but it's just, I can't take my eyes off it.
Gonna check in on you. I know where you live. If you're not on your way to becoming a veterinarian in 6 weeks, you will be dead. Now run on home.
And this, I mean, the message of this scene is great.
Run,
but
Force, run!
What an awful way to do it.
I feel ill.
Yeah, I mean, the message is fascinating, and it can be interpreted in many ways.
Come on, this isn't funny. That wasn't funny. What the f*** was the point of that?
Tomorrow will be the most beautiful day of Raymond Castle's life. His breakfast will taste better than any meal you and I have ever tasted.
You had to give it to him.
Come on.
He had a plan, and it started to make sense in a Tyler sort of way. No fear, no distractions. The ability to let that which does not matter truly slide.
Yeah, so after watching this scene, I had a conversation with a woman, a friend of mine, a close friend, somebody that I respect. And we had two very different interpretations of what that breakfast might taste like the next day. You know, my thought was, I get it. Like, if Tyler Durden's intentions are what we think they are, it is to inspire this man in whatever brutal way that was to go chase his dreams and be a vet. The next morning, he's going to be having his breakfast and somehow grateful that Tyler Durden put him through this and inspired him to go be a veterinarian and chase his dreams. When I mentioned that, to this woman, she's like, that's crazy. He's going to eat the breakfast the next day and feel like he was totally abused and beat up and not cared for and not inspired. So it just made me recognize how differently we're going to kind of interpret these scenes. I'd be very interested to hear from both of you, but also from the filmmakers on like what they think that breakfast would actually look like the next day.
That is interesting. What's great about, you know, the text of the film is, narrator says, it all started to make sense in a Tyler sort of way, which when you watch the scene, the entire scene is shot to make you believe Tyler. Yeah. We're looking up at him. He's in a position of power. He's being wise. He's being smart. We remove distractions when he delivers his, this is going to be the greatest day of his life. It's just Tyler and the narrator in the background. So the entire scene is designed to make you agree with him. And then narrator immediately undercuts it with that line. It makes sense in a Tyler sort of way.
Yeah.
And that's, yeah, I mean, as an 18-year-old, the first time I saw this, I was like, yeah, best day of his life is going to be that next day. And I look at it now, and I think I lean more towards agreeing with your friend, Gabe. That meal might taste like battery acid because he might be terrified that this guy's going to come hunt him down.
Yeah. I think it's going to taste good because he's glad to be alive. It does make me think of there are coaches and there are also parents who take tough love to such an extreme that the person doesn't feel loved. I mean, my personal philosophy is people can take strong feedback and even blunt correction if they feel respected and if they feel loved.
I'm going to knock that son of a down.
I know you are. You know why? Because you are Creed, and I love you, kid.
If they don't, they're going to get defensive and they're going to push back and fight you, or they're going to crumple because you bullied them too far.
The takes are all over the board, right? Like there are some, and this was not how my mother and father were, but there are some people who love their mother and father for how hard they were, how strict they were, and for setting them on this path, even if it wasn't done with love. And you know, perhaps they're not being completely honest, but maybe they look back on that and feel like it was the best thing for them. And I think one thing that's interesting about this scene, and you touched on it a little bit, Jonathan, is this is what near-death experiences are marketed as. You feel like you're going to die. The worst thing on the planet is about to happen. You survive the event, and therefore going forward, you act differently. Like, you know, maybe you have fewer days to live and, you know, you're going to
live like you were dying.
And I also ordered an extra slice of pie. Because you know how many times we live, Brian?
Once.
Once.
And I think that's how they're designed.
What is your style? Are you tough? Are you celebratory? Is it somewhere in between?
I'm honest.
Yeah.
I'm not, you know, when I think there are times when players need a lot of support, they need a lot of love, and they need a lot of tenderness. But it's only going to land that way if it's authentic. So I don't think you can force it with like words that don't ring as true, particularly in the moment as these guys are in competition. The flip side is also true, and you kind of touched on it earlier, Jonathan. You can't be like beating somebody over the head all the time. They're going to, you know, and you, even if it's like completely honest and authentic, they're going to be like, yeah, I can't take this anymore.
I am choking. And I'm not listening!
So I think from a management style, a coaching style, it's honest, it's direct, and it does come from a place of love almost always. It doesn't mean I'm always successful in demonstrating that, but those are always my intentions.
Yeah, well, and that's...
That's the human condition, man.
Yeah, for sure. But that's the thing I love about honesty is if someone earns your praise, they know you're not patronizing them. So they actually do feel good because they're like, I earned that. And if they get criticized or if they get feedback, they don't feel like they're being crucified for no reason, that it's also, like you're saying, coming from a place of respect.
I mean, and everybody needs a little bar raising and challenging and sometimes critical feedback. I mean, I think we'd all do better with a little bit more critical feedback. So I think those two things have to be in balance and harmony.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. Definitely. Moving forward with the story, narrator is, he started way over here in what he should be doing, but he's becoming more and more like Tyler, and then it's overcorrecting. He learns that Tyler is running a liberation
shadow terrorist organization that's going to destroy capitalism.
Yeah, it's going to destroy capitalism and free a bunch of men, but he starts to do things that he never would have done. He beats Jared Leto to a pulp.
Yep.
Probably, you know, foreseeing what we would all want to do after Suicide Squad.
Listen, you are my guests to this handsome hunka hunka.
What the hell did you just say?
We've all fantasized about beating Jared Leto to a pulp. Let's admit it.
He starts being cruel and dismissive to Marla, which used to be what Tyler would do.
Yep.
Once he discovers what Tyler's up to, he kind of snaps back to reality of, oh crap, this has gotten out of control.
Yeah.
I think it's interesting that Project Mayhem threatens to castrate the people who oppose them.
Yeah.
The implication, once again, to your point early on, is if you don't see masculinity the way we see it, you're not a man.
You're not worth anything.
Yeah, and we're going to make it literal, and we're going to make you not a man by taking your balls away.
Correct.
Yeah. But it's so fascinating to me that Tyler is always describing it as sport, but narrator realizes, I've been sleeping with Marla.
Uh-huh.
And wait a second, it's not just casual, like I actually do care a lot about her. Tyler's been awful to her, I thought that was Tyler, but it was me the whole time, and they have this conversation.
Well, I know that I've been acting very, very strange. Okay, I know that it's gotta seem like there's two sides to me when you're with
me. Two sides? You're Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Jackass.
I deserve that, but I've come to realize something very, very important.
What?
The full extent of our relationship wasn't really clear to me up until now for reasons I'm not going to go into, but the important thing is I know that I haven't been treating you so nice.
Yeah, whatever.
No. 15 seconds. 15 seconds, please. Please, 15 seconds. Don't open your mouth or move. I'm trying to tell you that I'm sorry, because what I've come to realize is that I really like you, Marla.
You do?
I really do. I care about you, and I don't want anything bad to happen to you because of me.
The wrestle that narrator has between his id side of Tyler and his own superego of what he should be doing, their relationship between narrator and Tyler demonstrates that. And here, when narrator realizes we're one and the same, I have to take ownership for what Tyler's been doing.
Yeah.
And I have to take ownership for my own actions. And in a film full of violence and posturing and kind of grotesque masculinity, we have this moment of real vulnerability, of real accountability and real tenderness, which is not what David Fincher is known for.
No, but he's such a fascinating filmmaker. You know, watching this movie, I don't think he thinks that this is what people are. I think he sees that this is what people can become, and he is critiquing it.
Yeah.
And I think that's what Chuck Palahniuk, who wrote the novel, was critiquing.
Yeah.
And because it's Fincher, he did it in such a stylish way that a lot of people, including 18-year-old me, got lost along the way and were like, yeah, cool.
Yeah, let's beat each other up, and that's the point. And the marketing was very, how cool is this?
Yeah.
And just, I remember hearing a bunch of teenage and young adult men talking about how this was the coolest thing they'd ever seen, and they wanted to be like Brad Pitt, and they all wanted to start fight clubs. And when the whole point is, yes, we need an outlet for our aggression, but what happens if those outlets, if the structures and the safety rails come off?
Right.
I think one thing that's interesting is as this tenderness comes out in the narrator for this kind of brief moment, and he starts expressing himself in a different way to Marla, very clearly the filmmakers want us to feel good about that, because they show us Marla's facial expressions just very receptive to this. Her eyes open up
softens
a little bit more. She demonstrates a little bit more attraction. And you can tell that she relaxes a little bit. I think that is sort of an endorsement of where the narrator is going in his development at that point.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think, once again, that's missed by a lot of 18-year-olds watching this for the first time.
Yep.
But not now that we're middle-aged watching it now. It rings completely differently. How does it, you were talking about how this movie lands so differently for you now.
Every time I've watched this film, which is, you know, 5 or 6 times now, because it's a fascinating movie, every time I watch it, I become a complete nihilist for about 3 days. Because it's the equivalent of an earworm song that just burrows into you and you can't get it out. And this is one of those, I mean, you were telling me you watched it and you just were thinking about it for days.
Yeah, I watched it and I I enjoyed it.
You didn't like it, right?
I enjoyed it artistically, but I didn't enjoy it personally as I was watching. I'm like, this is icky and gross. And then it wouldn't leave me.
Right.
And it, like 3 or 4 days later, I'm like, do I actually love Fight Club? And I realized that I did.
Yeah. I wasn't able as an 18-year-old to separate I love Fight Club from I love everything that is told to me in Fight Club.
Yeah.
It was only, you know, as I got older that I recognized that, you know, a lot of the things that Tyler is saying, they make sense in a Tyler Durden sort of way.
Yeah.
But, you know, stripped of the context of the film, like, this is awful stuff.
Yeah.
And in the context of the film, like, when narrator starts becoming a more whole person here, a more well person here at the end, this is the real message of the movie. This is what lands for me now. And it's, again, it is a grungy, gross, icky, dirty film to take you with narrator through this gross ickiness of his life to a place of wellness at the end, which you don't have to put a gun in your mouth to get there, but he did.
Please do not. And so I look at this and I see narrators now pushing back against Tyler. Fortunately, there is enough of narrator's conscience in Tyler that when he plans these terrorist attacks, it's specifically that no one's going to get killed.
Right.
You know, that we're fighting the establishment, not the people. But here, this battle between the conscience of the superego and the base desires of the id finally comes to a head in this final confrontation.
You created me. I didn't create some loser alter ego to make myself feel better. Take some responsibility.
I do. I am responsible for all of it, and I accept that. So please, I'm begging you. Please call this off.
Have I ever let us down? How far have you come because of me? I will bring us through this. As always, I will carry you, kicking and screaming, and in the end, you will thank me.
I'm grateful to you for everything that you've done for me. But this is too much. I don't want this.
What do you want? You want to go back to the job? Condo world watching sitcoms? I won't do it.
I love watching sitcoms.
It's already done, so shut up. 60 seconds. You see all right.
No. I can figure this out. I can figure this out. This isn't even real. You're not real. That gun is even in your hand.
The score is so disorienting and weird.
Hey, good for you. Doesn't change a thing.
And it's perfect. Cuts out.
Why you want to put a gun to your head?
Not my head, Tyler. Our head.
Interesting. Where are you going with this, IKEA boy? Hey, it's you and me. Friends.
Tyler. I want you to really listen to me. Are open.
I love the callback to nobody really listens to you unless they think you're about to die.
When people think you're dying, man, they really, really listen to you instead of just
waiting for their turn to speak.
Yeah.
Tyler's gonna listen to him now.
Tyler's gonna listen to him because he's about to die.
Oh, wow.
Yep.
So we have a player or a former player in our organization named Drew Robinson, who attempted suicide not that long ago. And I mean, I think the thing that stands out to me is when I watch this scene, I think about Drew and I think about, you know, what he was going through to get to that moment where he was going to shoot himself. That line that, you know, nobody listens to you until that moment is really powerful for me.
I think there's a measure of a lot of great art is there's a lot of different interpretations.
Yeah.
Here's my interpretation, at least for purposes of this episode and how I see it. The question out of the gate is, what does it mean to be a man?
Right.
Right. Starting in the testicular cancer group, that is kind of the thesis question of the film that we're going to explore and deconstruct masculinity and manhood. And here, I think it's boiled down to two things, two statements from narrator.
You need me.
No, I don't. I really don't anymore.
You created me. I didn't create some loser alter ego to make myself feel better. Take some responsibility.
I do. I am responsible for all of it, and I accept that.
I am responsible, and I don't need you anymore. Narrator originally didn't know how to be powerful. He didn't know how to be assertive. He was afraid of his own sexuality. He was afraid of his own power.
Yeah.
Because he thought he had to be afraid of those things in order to retain the structure and order of morality and integrity. And at this point, he's merged everything. He's got Tyler's confidence. He can lead the men without Tyler anymore.
Right.
Right? He's not afraid of his sexual attraction to Marla, or even beyond sexual attraction, that he has real legitimate...
honest to goodness, feelings and compassion for Marla.
Yeah, feelings and compassion and affection for Marla. He's not afraid of that. That now he feels strong and courageous and he can fight his own battles. But again, I am responsible. And as far as to Tyler, not to people, to Tyler, I don't need you anymore. Like, Tyler helped him find that middle ground.
Yeah.
What does it mean to be a man as we navigate this minefield of testosterone that contributes to aggression? Is I need a healthy outlet for my aggression. But like you were saying, Gabe, the film is reinforcing when narrator is vulnerable and affectionate and accountable, that that is rewarded by Marla, but also by the filmmaking, that is saying this is a good thing.
Right.
Right. So in the end, as we see here, he puts a bullet, you stop the, because this is a family channel.
We're not going to show this part because it's real bloody.
But with that, Tyler's gone. Again, I'm telling you as a clinician, this is not the solution for this.
Not the way to do this.
And for a lot
of
people,
get some therapy, work it out that way.
And for a lot of people with actual dissociative identity disorder, they live in harmony with the various personalities.
Sure.
And they don't actually want to be cured because there's nothing to cure. We're all sharing a body and we're all, you know.
All the alters are fine. Like, everything's fine.
Yeah. But in this case, Tyler had to go. But a narrator kills Tyler, but he also kills the old version of himself.
Right.
And he has merged the best parts of himself and the best parts of Tyler and shed the worst parts.
And that is summed up by the most understated line possibly in movie history.
You met me at a very strange time in my life.
There's a fair amount of in-your-face carnality in this film as far as its sexuality. And so it's telling to me that the last shot is him just kind of tenderly holding Marla's hand. He can't escape the consequences of what he's done. He's trying to stop it, and ultimately he can't.
Right.
But he can look forward to the future now that he's responsible and accountable and vulnerable with a sense of hope, which may be totally me projecting because I'm a therapist and that's what I want the film to say, but that is totally my read on it.
I think he recognizes how powerful he is in that moment. So obviously, like, I think you're right. Like, he recognizes that he can't really unwind everything, that's too late, but that, you know, like, whatever he decides to do in his life, he's got the components necessary going forward to handle that. And, you know, the building's collapsing and him being in this space with Marla is just evidence of that, right?
Yeah.
He's kind of seeing how influential he is in a very destructive way, but I think he's able to apply it in other ways going forward.
I don't know that he's looking forward with a lot of hope, because if he's really taking responsibility, dude's going to jail for a long time.
Yeah. He and Marla get conjugal visits, and that's about it.
Sure. That's what he's got to look forward to in life. It's a really fun scene because it's this sentimental moment where he's, you know, holding her hand, and it goes to that nice wide shot where you get to see the full body, and they're in profile as everything's coming down. And then the maybe greatest needle drop of all time, Where Is My Mind by the Pixies.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it's the most on-the-nose in the best possible way song ever.
Yeah.
It doesn't feel like losing your mind. It feels like missing something that's gone.
Yeah, yeah.
In a way, I don't know. It's
kind of like
it's a fascinating.
A sad sense of loss. Yeah. I miss my mind. I wish it would come back.
Where is my mind?
Find that balance. Have a healthy outlet for your aggression. Make sure you're still acting morally. That to be a real man, yes, you can be strong, but you can also be tender. And being vulnerable and being responsible doesn't make you any less. It makes you even more. That's a very mentally healthy place to be.
Accurate. Gabe, thank you so much for joining us. Where can people find you on social media? Obviously, they could cheer for the San Francisco Giants if they want to be wrong.
well, that's a
he does not represent both of us.
I have a nonprofit called Pipeline for Change. That's pipelineforchangefoundation.com. My Twitter handle is at Gabe Kapler. My IG is at Gabe Kapler as well.
Awesome. Give Gabe a follow. He is a fascinating man to follow around as he freaking slays in the NL West.
And just a really good guy. Like, you have every right to be a douche, but you're not. So hats off to you. Especially if that hat is a Dodger hat. Just take it off. Don't put it back
on. Don't put it back on. Okay.
So until next time.
I want you to hit me as hard as you can.
You met me at a really strange time in my life.
Whoa!
Whoa!
And
watch movies!
Oh, heavens no, not the green one. Pull anyone but the green one. I asked you not to do that!
Tyler, get away from the van!